Hey, what's up, guys? Aaron over here, and welcome back to the episode of my F1 2021 My Team Career Mode, episode number 16 today for the USA Grand Prix. If you guys did miss the previous one at the Japanese Grand Prix, then be sure to check that one out before you see this one, because that was a really excellent race for us versus AlphaTauri. We even raced the likes of Max Verstappen and beat a Red Bull, which was really awesome. Unexpected, obviously, the grid order was unexpected. Then the rain, very weird rain, that kind of, you know, was there, but the game was telling us it was dry, and then we were driving around on slicks on a very damp track. It was a very confusing Grand Prix. Not complaining, though, because in the end, both AlphaTauri scored no points. We scored a very excellent P7, was it? 6 points, whatever the case was. And that's massive for us, because now we're within, I think, 3 points, I think it was, or so, of AlphaTauri, which is big. You know, that's one more good race like that away from actually beating them in the standings. Obviously, there's still a few races to go, so let's not get ahead of ourselves. You know, there's still time for them to come back at us, but, you know, we're close. We can almost smell that P6 in the Constructors' Championship. We've got to refresh our sponsor. This is actually the very first sponsor that we signed to the team as a secondary sponsor, I should say. Obviously, Echo is our main title sponsor, but we already re-signed PSD a couple of episodes ago. Now, I was tempted to go with the exact same one that we had because that was a good goal, but you know what? Shark, the weekly goal, score more points than the team currently above you in the vehicle performance comparison, so the R&D chart, basically. So, you know, that would be, I think, Alpine or AlphaTauri. That's what we're aiming for anyway, every race, you know? So if we fail that, then we're not only failing the sponsor, we're failing ourselves as a team and as what I want to do as a driver. So I thought in the end, after debating other ones, you know, there were some other attempting offers, but I went with Shark in the end because, like I said, it makes sense. And also, if you guys have been around with me from F1 2020, at least from the start of that series on the last game, you'll remember that Shark was actually our very first title sponsor and the very first main sponsor on our car. So it's a nice little throwback as well to the F1 2020 series in a way, to see Shark back on the car, back on the halo as well, as it was on last year's game. But yeah, that objective, you know, that's what we're aiming for anyway, regardless of the money involved with it. So I'm hoping that we could get, and if we do get that, that's a decent payout. Actually, the bonus was very high, and the weekly payout anyway, the base payout, is pretty damn decent as well. So welcome to the team, Shark, onto the car, slapped up a few places, and then finally we've actually got quite a fair bit of time in between the Japanese and USA Grand Prix. The last couple of races have been so close together that there's been hardly any time to do any activity timeline kind of events to, you know, boost the team, boost the morale, or anything like that. So we're going to do all that good stuff and try and book in as much as we can effectively. And then looking at R&D, of course, we've almost got to a point where we're completely bottlenecked by our HQ facilities. We have purchased that spec 2 upgrade on the aero, but that's still going to come in. That's still pending. So what we can do is a tire upgrade. Now, although I don't think we need that much improvement on tire wear. Right now, as it stands, compared to most teams, I think through the season, we've been okay with those first two upgrades, but you may as well do it. We've got the R&D funds, and there's no point just sitting on the R&D, at least at the moment. You know, it's episode 16. I think we're going to start saving around episode 18, I would say. So in 2 episodes time, maybe pausing all the upgrades just to collect some R&D for the end of the season, that winter break period. But right now, thought that, you know, tire upgrade was a massive one. On that little comparison chart, that would leap us ahead by quite a fair bit. So you never know, maybe a lot of the other teams have done that, and it would allow us, to be fair, to do one stops easier. Even though, obviously, you guys know me, I love a good two stop. I really hate the current meta of Formula One in general, just not even in the game, even in real life. I hate the one stop races. I really prefer a two stop minimum race, but it is what it is. If we want to compete against the other teams, we're gonna have to upgrade the tire at some point, so we do. And thankfully, eventually, that engine power upgrade comes in. I literally can't remember now, but I think we may have had to repurchase that, or it just took a while to come in. So it's finally in now, so a big chunk of engine power is coming to the back of our car, and that's the perfect timing at a race like this, the Mexican Grand Prix, long main straight. You need the power through here. And now also at the same time, we can purchase an ERS upgrade, which literally is going to cost us 29 R&D because of the amount of discounts we got. So sometimes waiting is sometimes, you know, seems to be a good option, to be honest. If you're not wanting to spend too much R&D on certain areas and you can live without them, just try and long it out with the practice programs and eventually you'll get them for really cheap. So definitely, if you're not desperate, just wait for the discounts and then you can get them on the cheap completely. But we've got an HQ facility event here, and this one was a really weird one because it was... well, both negative. Like, both outcomes were negative. Either Eilat loses focus, or the aerodynamics morale is minus 10%, because apparently there's a system crash on the IT, and either we could get Eilat to redo the laps in the simulator, or get the aerodepartment to kind of reconfigure it. I just went with minus morale on the aerodepartment, because on the activity timeline, I've got an activity that's going to boost the aero morale, so it should balance out to them being fine. Right now, they're probably on poor morale, but by the time that activity happens, we should be fine with the aero team building, as you can see right there. So that should be all fine and dandy. In fact, the morale is now high on the aero department. So yeah, pretty much got away with not having Eilat even lower on focus than he already is. And on the note earlier of getting discounts on the engine, because we waited, obviously all we've got in the practice programs right now at the moment is engine upgrades and our reliability in terms of the boosters, because the game realizes that we're pretty bottlenecked. We don't have many upgrades to go on the chassis, if any, and we don't have any on the aero. Basically, we're waiting for spec 2, which will come in soon, I think. I don't actually know the timeline of how long it's going to take that HQ facility to come in, but once it does, we will have spec 2 unlocked on the aero side, which is going to be rather exciting. But we're now getting to qualifying then Saturday for the US GP Circuit of the Americas. This was always a very difficult circuit on F1 2020. The AI was super consistent around here, and the tire temperatures were an absolute nightmare. Like, you had to lift and coast through sector one just to protect the inner carcass temperature. Thankfully, on this year's game, I mean, I think you probably would have guessed by now, because I haven't complained about it one single episode, the tire temperatures aren't much of an issue this year. It's more just the raw tire wear, the actual like grip levels of the tire, rather than the actual temperature themselves. So I'm curious to see. It probably will be quite high, because Kota in real life is quite an abrasive surface around here, and also just the high speed nature of it means you're going to have high tire wear, just like Silverstone. Obviously, that's sector one mimicking Magnus and Beckett, so you're just going to have that kind of level of degradation that you're not going to get at, you know, let's say more flatter circuits like the Russian Grand Prix, for example. So here we are then in Q1 on our second lap, trying to improve a fair amount. A little bit of understeer once again through the last corner. Always have that in the last couple of F1 games. But we're going to make it through just about through to Q2. Very, very close, I must say, which is kind of not great news for me, because, you know, Gasly's right up there now for towering P10. So if he's got pedigree to get into Q3, if that's as good as the AlphaTauri car could be this race weekend, then we might be in trouble. I've got to try and pull a worldly lap out of the bag on this run in Q2, but we only have one fresh set of soft tires to use in this one, so don't have much to play around with. It's kind of a stab into the unknown of what this lap is going to do for us. Let's see as we go to the line across it. I think that was P 13. I was going to say 14 on the top left. 13, not bad. That's actually not bad. That was a lot better than I thought. I thought we were going to have a disaster and be down to P 15, you know, in between Ocon and Raikkonen, like we were at Japan and the last couple. But yeah, Gasly showing some good pace. P11 there, a good 5 tenths quicker than us. And the same with Alonso. That's a little bit worrying in terms of race pace. I know we improved, but still, that is some really good pace from Pierre Gasly. So maybe AlphaTauri might be pouncing back and punching back at us this episode following such a good one for us at Japan. But let's see. Let's go to the grid. No rain involved. It's just going to be the dry tire performance and the tire wear that's going to be an issue. Let's go to the grid.
Here we are then in one of the fastest growing cities in the United States, the fabulous Austin in the great state of Texas. The circuit itself, 14 miles southeast of the city center and home to the US Grand Prix since 2012. The latest in a long list of iconic tracks to have that honor. We have 10 turns to the left and 10 to the right here at the fantastic Circuit of the Americas. Overtaking opportunities into turn 1 and 12 at this anti-clockwise 3.6 mile track. And we should see average lap speeds of around 126 miles per hour. It's just about time to go to the track for the beginning of the race, but before we do, Anthony Davidson, what types of strategy do you think we can expect for today's event?
Well, there's a lot that both the driver and the team have to keep in mind when going into a race. The tyres, fuel, energy recovery systems, the list goes on and on. But I think the key to today's victory will come down to the pit stop strategy. Come in too soon and you might find yourself needing more than one stop. Too late and you're putting yourself at a disadvantage by spending longer on worn tyres.
Before we begin, let's take a quick look at the grid lineup for today's race. Valtteri Bottas lines up on pole position, and it's Lewis Hamilton alongside. As we continue through the rest of the grid today, we have Norris, Perez, Charles Leclerc and Sainz, Vettel, Stroll, Gasly and Daniel Ricciardo. They've taken a grid penalty. The owner driver, Tsunoda, Esteban Ocon and Fernando Alonso, Verstappen, Giovinazzi, Mick Schumacher and Kimi Raikkonen, Russell, Mazepin. They'll be starting further back after an earlier grid penalty. Latifi and Callum Ilott. That's it then, it's time to go racing as we head to trackside for today's race.
So once again, we've been helped out by some grid penalties for some other races and we've been bumped up to P11, not as high as we were at Japan, weirdly enough. Obviously, I'm still baffled at how we were that high. But anyway, in terms of the race strategy, apparently it's a one stop from the soft to the hard compound attire. But I have the feeling that just like last year's game, the soft tyre is going to wear out so quickly. And so that one stop may be quite difficult on the soft compound. And that maybe going on the medium is going to be maybe a better shout. I feel like the hard, you just don't want to be on the hard tyre. So the least amount of laps we can be on that tyre, the better. So if we go on the mediums and extend the medium tyre stint, we can then effectively just be on the hard tyre for even less. Doing this strategy, I am the only one who's going to start mediums, which I don't know. That may mean that it's completely the wrong way to go. I'm not too sure. Or it might just mean that we pull off a genius tactic. I don't know. You're going to try these things. We're on a new game. It's the first time we've come to USA in the career mode, let alone any race, really. So we've got to try these things. If you don't know, you don't know. So, you know, if it doesn't work out, we'll know for the future not to do this. But I think, I don't know, I just get a hunch. The vibe is the hard tyre is going to be horrendous. Horrendous in that you just don't want to be on that tyre for a while. It's either this or a two-stop, which, to be fair, I think would be good for us, but I don't know if we have the pace to do a two-stop and get in the points. I think very much we're going to have to try and get track position around a circuit like this. So here we are then, looking to maybe overtake AlphaTauri in the championship, possibly after this one, if we have a good one. Let's go to five red lights, and we're underway for the USA Grand Prix, and it's a really slow start. The medium tyre, the grip level's not there initially on the get-go. We dive down the inside, though, of Daniel Ricciardo, who's a bit further down the order already, considering where McLaren have been in the previous races. I mean, Lando Norris's teammate won the whole Japanese Grand Prix, but look at that, almost four wide. Really aggressive stop there, and Pierre Gasly round the outside. Gasly with a fantastic overtake on Daniel Ricciardo. Snap of oversteer as the heavy fuel sector one, not the same as it was in qualifying for sure, just like Silverstone, really getting a shock to the system of how much you have to lift off on the heavier fuel there. But Gasly with a really great overtake on Ricciardo to get up into P9. But some aggressive driving from Sebastian Vettel, Leclerc, Stroll there into the S section. Tsunoda behind us. So we've already got one AlphaTauri behind. Now we chase after Gasly. But let's look at this replay. Ricciardo down in P10. But Lando Norris, another cracking start. And it may even be better than Japan, because look at this down the inside. Lando Norris, he won last time out at Japan, and he is now leading the USA Grand Prix on lap number one. What an overtake. Double move on the outside of the two silver arrows. Wow, he is really fly. His focus must be very high as an AI driver. And he's still there in first place on the minimap on lap number three. The rears lock a little bit there. And I can't lie, already within three laps, I'm starting to struggle and I'm starting to, you can maybe guess what I'm about to say, regret the decision of going on to medium. Obviously, we need to give it some time. Maybe once the tyre wear kicks in for the soft tyre runners, this medium set's going to feel pretty good. But right now, those soft tyres are so much quicker. You could have probably seen it from the get-go, from lap one off the five red lights. The biting point for everyone else was so much better. It was ridiculous. I think that was probably one of our worst starts that we've had in terms of actually off the line. Of course, we made it work with a little dive into turn one, but Tsunoda is coming at me at a rate of knots, four laps gone, and I'm 3.2 seconds behind the top 10 pack. This is ridiculous, and Tsunoda round the outside, we're having to really defend, lock up at the front left and go as late as we dare on the brakes to stop the Japanese driver getting through, and this is pain, this is a struggle. I'm quickly realizing, yeah, okay, maybe the hards are horrendous around Kota, maybe the mediums are horrendous, maybe the two-stop, that two-stop strategy I said we were maybe too slow for, maybe that's the motive, maybe everyone's going to do that, I don't know right now, but all you can see is that I am just very, very slow. So if I could do it all over again, I probably definitely wouldn't have chosen the mediums, and now we know for the future not to choose the mediums, at least, you know, at least this stage of our career with where the car is. But Tsunoda, eventually, lap number five, I can't defend him anymore. He's down the inside, he's got the overspeed, and he's just got the overwhelming grip mid-corner to just keep the pressure on us, and so we have to let him go. So right now at the moment, both AlphaTauri cars are ahead of us, and Tsunoda is pulling away somewhat, but we are still within DRS, so if there's half a chance I could re-overtake him, we will. But to be honest, I really need the soft tires to start wearing out soon, because even if we overtake him, I don't know how long we could keep him behind, basically. But a late break there for us. Oh, what the... Oh, what the hell just happened there? Yuki Tsunoda has spun out right in front of us. No contact from us. He just... What? He just floored it and lost it. Is that the tyre wear for him kicking in, maybe? I don't know. That was very similar to, cast your minds back to the Spanish Grand Prix. Round number, what was it? Two or four of this season, episode four of the series, when Giovinazzi span it at turn one and crashed with Valtteri Bottas. Remember? It was a similar thing to this. Audibly, it was a similar thing where the AI just seemed to floor the throttle and he just spun the car on his own accord, basically. I thought I maybe tapped him, but with that late brake zone, but I was nowhere near him. It was almost like lag. It looked like lag bubble from F1 2012, but yeah, very, very strange indeed. So now we move later, much later on, to lap number 9. Esteban Ocon attacking us a little bit at turn 1, but Hamilton is already in for his first stop, and he's ahead of us, so... And that's not too bad, to be fair, because if he's doing a two-stop, if he's pit this early onto a set of softs, if he's doing a two-stop, maybe there is a chance we could still jump some people on a one. But as we get through the laps, I guess we're going to find out what everyone's doing. Ricciardo and Stroll on hard tyres, so they're doing a one-stop. So we've got a bit of split strategy here. Bottas on hard. So Bottas is doing a one-stop, but Hamilton is on a two. Hamilton's ahead of Bottas right now. But I don't think that... I think Hamilton may have just screwed himself. He can't screw himself too much because I think he just lost the championship lead to Bottas last episode, or there's only like 2 points in it between him and Bottas at the top of the standings. He's on the two, but he's only just ahead of Bottas, and Perez has come out just ahead of us on the hard. So we've got majority of people doing the one stop. Norris on hard, Sainz on hard, and you can see I'm just going as long as we can. Sainz down the inside eventually on that new set of tyres. Lap 12, this is around the time our pit strategy was open for the pit stop onto hard tyres, but the thing is, I'm in P6 right now, but look at the minimap. There's so many cars near to me. If I pit now, I'm going to be well and truly out of this race. No chance whatsoever. So in my mind, you know, laps, you know, 28 laps in total, the softs, Perez there, who pit the latest out of everyone, he took his softs 10 laps, didn't he? Or right, 9 or 10. So if we can get to just about lap 17 or 18, we could go into a set of soft compound attire. That's a pretty crazy one-stop, mediums or softs. But the thing is, clearly you've seen, the soft compound, even with tyre wear, is the best race tyre around here. Even with tyre wear, it's got better grip than the medium and hards. So we may just be able to come back at people. So we're going to go for it. I'm going to risk it. We've already risked it anyway with mediums, and that's not worked out. So we need to re-risk it to try and save the race and salvage something, just some points, to limit the damage from Pierre Gasly, who's well into the points paying position. So we trundle on lap number 16, going to get passed by Lance Stroll, but obviously he's not in our race, so there's a reason why we're not putting up any fights right now. I will admit, this race so far has just looked at, it's basically looked like us struggling every lap, and we have been, and letting everyone by, but it's because no one in this race right now is in our race, if that makes sense. Like, no one is racing us at the moment. We're trying to just survive this stint and get to lap 17, 18. We're now going to say box in this lap because the tyre wear is, well, absolutely horrendous. So at no point in this stint, I want to add, these mediums come to life. There was no, you know, rubbing in of the tyre compound, you know, heating up. It never, you know, I've never even experienced a hard tyre like this on F1 2020. You know, on F1 2020, eventually there was a point where a hard tyre would become good once it rubbered in. This medium was absolutely gopping. 73% on the front left. I don't know how we survived that. Very much puncher territory. But now we've done it. We're out onto a set of soft compound tyres for 10 laps. So we can just give it full beans and see what we can do. Perez is pit again? I think, oh, Perez must have surely had an issue with someone, like a front wing damage or something, because he's pit again off hard tyres, so he's done a two-stop that he definitely doesn't want to do, and he's on mediums, and he's on the mediums that I well know are horrendous, to the point where, here we are, lap number 19, and we are actually catching a Red Bull on pure pace. Unlike Japan, no rain to help us out. This is legit just pure pace and tyre difference here. This is how quick the soft tyre is versus the mediums. I'm able to overtake Perez pretty comfortably and go on and chase after Max Verstappen, set the purple second sector. Probably going to go on to set the fast lap of the Grand Prix because we're the only man now on the soft compound attire. So yeah, in conclusion, guys, for you all at home and future seasons, for me, future Arab, never go on the mediums. Try and avoid the hards. Basically, try and do a three-stop with softs if you could get away with it. But basically, two sets of softs and maybe then the hards or mediums right at the end for a few laps. But you want to be a majority of the race on softs, at least right now in the My Team Season 1 car, because my God, yeah, it's night and day. The grip levels is so much better on the soft. I mean, so much so that we're literally catching Verstappen. We're now 1.6 behind Max Verstappen. So we are racing him last episode around Japan, keeping back. Today we're chasing after him, and we're actually doing it. We've got four laps left, though. The tyre wear will kick in a bit for the softs, and look at the bottom right. We've got negative fuel, minus 0.38. Now, I didn't actually underfuel the car at all. I think I like got very close to the calculated number of laps we needed of fuel, and the calculation was clearly wrong. And by lap 26, I'm sorry to say, our race has fallen apart because the tyre wear kick in now, and we need to try and lift and coast. Vettel's passes, and I don't know what to do on the fuel. I've said this before, and people have said in the comments, oh, why don't you just lift and coast and short shift? I know how to do that. I've been watching Formula One for a while. I know how do you save fuel. Short shift, lift and coast. But on this game, that's not enough. Like, if you're minus 0.35, there is no way to save enough fuel unless you're lifting off pretty much halfway down the straight. Perez here coming to attack us. This has just become an absolute torture of a race. Perez round the outside squeezes us in to turn one. We're on the last lap of the Grand Prix and my race has fallen apart because we're out of fuel. The tyre wall wasn't there. If it wasn't for the fuel, we could have maybe stayed with Verstappen within about 3 seconds. But the tyre wear kicked in, so we would have only settled for P10. But we can't even get P10 because we've lost it to Vettel and Perez because we need to lift and coast. Meanwhile, Lando Norris, he was leading the race. Unfortunately for him, Bottas is going to win this one. But it's so close. Literally, Norris is running him to the line. Literally, the top three are covered by 1 second there. But Hamilton will lose more points to Bottas in the championship. That's massive for Bottas, who will take a decent lead in the championship. And Pierre Gasly, you saw there, was loving life, high in the points. He's going to get 6 points back on me. So, you know, if you thought it was bad luck for AlphaTauri and you felt like AlphaTauri got bad done by, you know, with Yuki Tsunoda's penalty or whatever around Suzuka last episode, well, it's all karma. It's balanced back. I got 6 points. AlphaTauri gets 6 points because here we are, dismal settings, low fuel mode. Codemasters, what is this? What is this? How is there no ability to go to lean mixture at the end of the race? Like, what do you want me to do? You can't lift and coast and short shift enough to save over minus 0.2 of fuel. It can't be done unless you've got a safety car. What is the point of locking off lean mixture? I know there's no rich mix, but what's the point of locking off lean mixture? Absolute, just such an annoying race. This one really annoyed me. The tyre choice was wrong. The fuel, well, I mean, we called it close on fuel, but for some reason, this car was just very thirsty around Kota. And then, yeah, I mean, just all round pain. It was just torture. Lap after lap, nothing.
Championship as well. What a spectacular season they've had. Congratulations to the whole team. Talk to me, Ants. What was it that set them apart from the competition today?
Well, this was a real team victory. They put together a solid strategy today that appeared well suited to the conditions out on track. The driver did everything that was expected of them in the moment to really execute the team's plan to perfection. A shining example of how F1 really is a team sport.
Mercedes are on top form once again after an excellent race weekend. It's great to see them up on that podium once again.
So this really is an alternative F1 universe, because not only are McLaren winning three races with Norris winning two, Valtteri Bottas is the man at Mercedes. He's leading the championship, I think by a decent margin now as well, in terms of, you know, in context to how close it's been and how far Hamilton was at one stage earlier on this season. 9 points Bottas is ahead. Hamilton will really need to pull up his socks and do a lot better. I mean, he's capable of winning the races, but Bottas, he's got some momentum there. And also, obviously, Norris and Ricciardo, the two McLarens annoying them, is not helping. But there you go, 44 points. We stay put. And AlphaTauri on 53. So they get the 6 points back. So it's karma, I guess, a little bit, because we got very lucky at Japan. So AlphaTauri got lucky. Well, not lucky. Gasly actually just had great pace. We did not. The My Team car was horrendous around USA. The tyres, horrendous. Fuel saving, horrendous. Absolute pain. And this was a torturous Grand Prix to record. My word, I want to see the back of it. Long live Mexico. Hopefully that's going to be a good one for us. Our car should suit it with the straight line speed, low drag and such. But this one, I'm glad to see the back of it. Guys, if you did enjoy the episode, then hit that like button. Let me know what you thought in the comments below. If you're around here, then do get subscribed for weekly Formula 1 content. I'll see you guys next time. Goodbye.